بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام ربنا سبحانه وتعالى، وخير هدى هدي رسولنا المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم ما بعد، a few weeks ago we talked about the issue of death and some of the fiqh of death and how it's not going to miss anyone. And since the death is an ultimate meeting that everyone is going to have, then obviously there's going to be the good death and there's going to be the bad death. So today, inshallah, azza wa jalla, we deal with, again, one of the many issues in which our deen has dealt with in very perfect detail, what the ulama of al-Islam have called the Husnul Khatima, the signs that are present for a person who dies, and the ones who stay behind, they can look at his death as being possibly a good death, and ultimately the situation is with Allah Azza wa Jalla. It's not permissible for us to make what is known as al-jazm, to be absolutely sure concerning a person's death, good or bad. A man, throughout his life, he may do the deeds of the people of Al-Jannah, and then what was written upon him and for him overtakes him right before he dies, and then he does the deeds of the people of the hellfire, and he enters into the hellfire. And in contrast, a person may do the deeds of a person of the hellfire, and then right before he dies, what was written upon him and for him from the Qadr, it overtakes him, and right before he dies, he does the deeds of the persons of the people of the Jannah, and he goes into the Jannah. So we don't know, and Allah Azza wa Jalla, He knows. So we can never make, again, what is known as al-jazm, to emphatically, absolutely state that this person, he had a good death, or this person, he had a bad death. We say, based upon the text, it appears that he had a good death. And based upon the text of the Kitab and the Sunnah, it appears he had a good death. The man came and he said to the Nabi of Al-Islam, Al-Mustafa, Al-Sadiq, Al-Masduq, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Al-Mujtaba, Ya Rasulullah, if you would have only witnessed that guy, this man over here who was making the jihad and he was killing everybody from the enemies. He was doing an excellent job. He had chivalry, he had bravery, and he was competent when it came to fighting. He took care of the enemy. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told the people, he's from the people of the hellfire. And the companions didn't doubt what he said, although they saw with their own eyes that this man was getting busy and doing the business on the land of al-jihad. So when they heard that, when they re-engaged the enemies of al-Islam, they made sure to watch what was that man doing. Turned out that one of the non-Muslims wounded him, stabbed him, and the wound didn't kill him, but he was stabbed, And he wasn't patient with what had hit him. So he put his sword in the ground and he threw himself on the sword and he committed suicide. And the people, they went back and they said, Ya Rasulullah, you told the truth. This is what the man did. So he said to the people, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Inna Allaha layansuru bihadha, layansuru hadha deen bi rajulin fajirin. It may be that Allah will help this religion with an evil man because he committed suicide. It's not the time or the place to get into the details of that hadith, that the Prophet described that man who was from his companions as being an evil man. So how do we reconcile that all of the companions are in the Jannah? It's not the time to get into that. The point here is how the companions of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw one thing and they didn't know the reality of that thing until the text came to them and told them his reality is opposite of what you think it is. And that's why we have a number of ayat in the Kitab of Allah, and this is extremely important in our lives. Those of us who want to get married, and we have ikhlas, and we may have difficulty, and we may have our parents who are not cooperating, and you really, really want to marry that sister or that brother, but your parents are giving you a hard time, and someone says to you, leave that thing, leave it all together. And you can't even conceive where they're coming from. Because in your mind, in your heart, in your spirit, in your soul, you really want to get married. And you feel it's the best thing for you because you really like that girl or she likes that brother. But we don't know and Allah knows. That's why we have a number of ayat about this. And this point is crucial as human beings. As we live and we hear this today, until you die, We have to all know and understand. You may think the best issue is the way you're looking at it and the way you feel about it, with all of the good and positives that are in the equation, but you don't really know. There are a number of ayat of the Quran that came, not just one ayat, a number of ayat to show us never be one of those individuals who you exist and you exist in a way in which you're saying, I'm absolutely sure that the thing that I'm trying to do is the best thing for me. You have to say, Allah knows best. I'm just doing the best that I can. But it is possible that it's not the best thing. From those ayats, Surat An-Nisa, ayat number 19, as it relates to those of us who are married, concerning wanting to divorce your wife, wanting to get a khula and get out of that relationship. In Surah An-Nisa, Allah Ta'ala mentioned, فَإِنْ كَرِهْتُمُهُنَّ فَعَسَنْ تَكْرُهُ شَيْئًا وَيَجْعَلُ اللَّهُ فِيهِ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. You men, if there is something or some things that you dislike about your wife that are causing you to think about divorcing her and separating from her and moving on, it may be that Allah Ta'ala has put in that thing a lot of good. You don't like it. You don't like what's going on. But it may be that in it is a lot of good. That if you stay in it, the sister, the brother, maybe from your children and in the future of that child, a lot of khair is going to come as a result of you sticking to it. So that's one of the many ayat that go to show. You may feel one particular way. You may have an opinion about something like that marriage. But Allah has put a lot of good in that thing. And there are things about it that you dislike. Another example of that, and there are many, is that Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned, وَعَسَنْ تَكْرُهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَنْ تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. It may be that you hate something that Allah has put a lot of good in it. And it may be that you love and you like something but it is harmful for you. It's no good for you. Allah knows and you don't know. It's the second ayah. Two ayahs with the same message. Allah could have given us just one ayah, but two ayahs to bring the point home. A third ayat, so that there's no doubt that the person shouldn't allow himself to exist in a way where he says, I'm absolutely 110% sure that this is the thing and it's the best thing. You have to slow down and pump your brakes and do your best. That's how you feel. You have to get some advice from other people. You have to take your time. The third ayat, Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned, وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. You think that the thing that you're doing is small, it's insignificant. But when Allah, with Allah, it is tremendous. It's a big thing. This thing, the way that you're looking at it, you think that it's small. You think that it's insignificant. You think it's just wiping some dirt off of your shoulders. But Allah, this decision you are about to make, it is azim. Another ayat showing, don't be strong and wrong at the same time. You can have your own opinion. You made your assessment. You know how you feel. But you always have to have in the back of your mind, maybe I'm not doing the right thing. Maybe I'm not doing the best thing. Another ayat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, فَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْرَهُونَ بِمَا أَتَوْ وَيُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يُحْمَدُوا بِمَا لَمْ يَفْعَلُوا فَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّهُمْ بِمَفَازَةٍ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Do not think, don't think concerning the munafiqeen, the hypocrites. Don't think that those people who love to be praised by that which they have been given, and they love to be praised for what they didn't do, munafiqeen, don't think that they're going to be saved from the punishment. Verily, their punishment is going to be severe. So you may be looking at it a particular way, your hisab, how you look at it, your dhan, the way you feel it is that they're going to get this, they're going to get that. A good ending, a bad ending. You think it's like that. You think it's good because she or he felt under the realm of some of the circumstances that we're going to share with you, inshallah. So you think that it's a good thing. It's a good khatima, or it's a bad one. That's how you think it is. Allah knows and you don't know. That's four ayat. Another one of those statements of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala concerning that, وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتًا بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَقُونَ. Don't think that those people who have been killed in the way of Allah, don't have your dhan, don't have your hisab, don't think that they're dead. No, they're not dead. They are alive with Allah Azza wa Jal, and He's providing for them. So these five ayat of the Quran, they go to show that there always has to be a level of uncertainty or a level of I may be wrong whenever we come to our conclusions. So even if a person were to see a lot of negativity that will cause him not to compromise his honor, he is a man who's aziz and he has strength, he has a rajula, he's a real man. He doesn't want to be played out of pocket. He doesn't want to be made to be a fool. And something happens and he says, I'm going to do this. This is the best thing to do to maintain and protect my manliness. And you're absolutely sure. Don't be absolutely sure to that degree. Keep your mind open for another interpretation and for advice. And keep your mind open to be advised. Don't be of those people. No one can afford to be of those people in many of the issues that are concerning our lives to be to the degree where you're not listening to anyone else and you close your ears. So when we talk about the people who have been described as having a good ending. I can't sit here and say anyone who falls under the description and under the realm of what we're going to share with you, he has definitely fulfilled the conditions and he or she is in the Jannah. La wallahi. But when we hear about these hadith and about these ayat, they give us a sense of hope. A sense of hope. A few weeks ago, about a month and some change now, I went to Al-Medina to participate in a very serious seminar. When I was on the plane and I got off of the plane, I saw a Sheikh Haytham Al-Haddad who came here yesterday. And when I saw him getting off of the plane and we were about to get on the transportation to take us to the airport from the tarmac, he didn't seem himself. I looked at him, I said, something looks wrong with him. He just wasn't himself. When I went up to him, he still didn't seem himself. He told me that his father had died. And he was a bit discombobulated, to be honest with you. He just wasn't himself. He was discombobulated. Wasn't like totally, fully there. I said to him on that transportation, hey, whatever the case is, I'm able to say to you, A'zam Allah ajrakum. May Allah increase your reward. Isbir wahtasib. Be patient. You'll get your reward. He's going to be in the Jannah and things like that. And that's because you guys that were raised on al-Islam, when your relatives die, we're going to say to you, be patient, you'll get your reward. We're going to say to you, your mother, father, aunt, uncle, he's in Jannah, inshallah, if he died on Tawheed. Some of us who have embraced Islam, and our mothers and our fathers are kuffar, when I hear from someone who is a revert, Sikh, Hindu, Christian, whatever, he says, my mother died, my father died. It's like a moment of awkwardness. It's a moment of awkwardness. I can't say to that individual, Allah yarhamuhu. May Allah put her in the Jannah al-Firdaus. I can't say that. I have to ask the question. Was he a Muslim? Was he not a Muslim? If the answer is no, can't say anything except that which pleases Allah. As the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, when his son Ibrahim died, he said, "Inna al-ayn tadma' wal-qalbu yahzanu, wa la naqulu illa ma yurda Rabbana, wa inna lamahzunun limafariqika ya Ibrahim." Our eyes shed tears, and our hearts, they are overwhelmed with sadness and sorrow, but we will only say what pleases our Lord. O Ibrahim, we are sad that you have left us. You're not here anymore, you left us. So we're not going to say what is not from our religion. Oh Allah, why you do that? What is this? We're not going to say that. But those of you, and this is the point, your parents, your relatives who died with La ilaha illallah, you can put the situation into perspective with what we're going to share with you right now, inshallah. Someone who died, your eyes shed tears, your heart, you're overwhelmed with sorrow. You're overwhelmed. But you can say, this hadith is applicable to my mother, my father, so I hope. When I went to Al-Medina recently, as we shared with the community, there was a brother who's become quite close with me. His father went, performed Umrah. Became deathly ill. We were hoping, praying that he would pull out of it. He died. And it was tough. Believe me when I say that it was tough. I felt the pain of the brother, of his father, of his mother, his brother and his sister. And I heard about all the drama going on with his relatives who were back here in the UK. But the father died in Al-Medina. And one of the signs of a good khatima is what he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Man istata'a minkum an yamut bil madinati فليفعل فإني آتي يوم القيامة له شفيعة. Any of you has the ability to die in Medina, then let him die in Medina. He has cancer, and they say, you about to check out, and you really are going to check out. And the way it looks, he's going to check out. Get a ticket and go to Medina and die over there. Because if you were to do that, the Prophet guaranteed and he promised. And as Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said about him, when he used to say his hadith, Haddathani as-sadiq al-mustuq, I was told by the one who speaks the truth, and he should be believed. And then he would say the hadith. So if a person were to die in Al-Medina, the eyes shed tear and the heart is overwhelmed with grief, but he died in Medina. And the most truthful human being said, he's going to bear witness for him, Yawm al-Qiyamah, and be an interceder for him. So it's hope for you. But can you make a jazm and say, Wallahi, my father's in Jannah, because the Prophet said? No, it may be that your relative did something, or he was doing something, his aqidah, his belief, his behavior, something was going on that disqualifies him from this hadith that made you feel maybe he's going to be like that. So we can never make al-jazm, but you can put it in to perspective. Those of us who are reverts, the mother, the father, they died on their deathbed. They said to their child, after the child was spending 4, 5 years, 10 years, giving them dawah ila Allah, right before they died, the day that they died, the mother, the son, the daughter said, hey, ma, just say you believe in Allah. La ilaha illallah. And they say that. And they didn't say Muhammad Rasulullah. They didn't get to that. They died. We're going to say, hey, hope. There's hope. As for the knuckleheads who come and say, you didn't say the other half. Your mother, your father going to be burning in hell with Abu Lahab. We're going to say, man, get a grip, man. Get a life. Abu Talib, the Prophet told him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, uncle, say la ilaha illallah, kalimatun, ana uhajjallahu laka biha indallah. I'm going to argue with just that word, la ilaha illallah. He didn't say Muhammad Rasulullah. So again, as we mentioned, there are some people, I don't know, Ikhwani, there's just some people, they're just dark in the way that they live. They're dark. So the shahid and the point here is, in delivering this lecture, this dars, this reminder, no one can absolutely say, as they say here in the UK, hand on heart, Wallahi, he's going to go to Jannah because he died in it. You can't say that. And for that reason, the great Imam and the Amir in Al-Hadith, Al-Imam Al-Bukhari, Rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, in his Sahih Bukhari, in his book, he has a chapter in the Bab. He called it Bab La Yaqulu Fulanun Shaheed. The chapter of the impermissibility of saying so and so is a Shaheed. One of the signs that a person died a good death is that he died as a Shaheed fi sabilillah. And again, I say to you guys, normative Islam is under attack in Europe. They will come to your child and they will say to your child in the school, if you were driving the car and you're going to Fajr with your dad and you're late and there's a red light, what should you do and what should your dad do, Ilyas? And Ilyas is just an innocent little man. Ilyas, based upon his lack of knowledge, based upon his hirs, his emotions, he said, run the red light. They say, you're extreme. You're extreme. And then they come and kick your door down. Or in another situation, they put these kind of situations to our children. Your child, he breaks his arm, la samahallah. He goes to the doctor goes to the lawyer, goes to one of these people from the private sector who has taken some special training for 2 hours. Now he is Mahir Bil Islam, Alimun Bil Islam. He's a scholar in Islam. Here we are. We've been Muslims all our lives and we're not scholars. And this individual, non-Muslim, takes an hour and a half, 2 hours of training under this prevent, and now he becomes Mutamekkin Mahir, Alim. And he says to little Ilyas, you know, Ilyas, in your religion, tell me, what do you think? You know, the people, they're supposed to be equal and everything like that. Everybody's equal. Do you believe that as a Muslim, you're going to paradise and everybody else is going to the hellfire? If Mahir or if Ilyas doesn't answer, all of the spokes of the wheel, they lead to the center. We all go to Jannah. If he says, yeah, I believe only the Muslims are going to paradise. Because Allah said in the deen and the light, Islam. Allah is only going to accept Islam. And Muhammad is the best individual. He's not supposed to say that. Muhammad is the single best individual. Every Friday, Ilyas is hearing that. Inna khayr al-kalam, kalam Allah. Wa khayr al-huda, huda Rasulillah. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the Sayyid of Bani Adam. That's Islam. But with the way things are going right now, that's not going to be acceptable. Normative Islam is under attack. So the point here is, we're not making a jism about any of this. If someone were to die and any of these ahadith ayat are applicable to him, it gives you hope to put it in perspective. It just gives you hope. But Allah ultimately is the one who knows best. Allah knows best. But we can't absolutely say for sure whether it's good or whether it is bad. But you have hope. Meaning he died with one of these examples. We don't say, well, Allah, he's in Jannah. He died with the opposite of these examples. We don't say that he is in the hellfire. We don't say that. Not at all. It's not for you to say that. The Prophet said that Allah said in Hadith al-Qudsi, Man dhal-ladhi yata'ala alayya. Who is it, the one that has the nerve and the audacity to say what I'm going to do and what I'm not going to do? Allah's going to put so-and-so in the hellfire, so-and-so in the hellfire. We judge based upon what is apparent. And we say, based upon our religion, he died as a Muslim, from what I know. So as long as he said, La ilaha illallah, he's going to the Jannah, ultimately. Will he be punished? Allahu alam. Is he definitely going to be punished? I can't say that. He drank khamr. He did this. He did that. She did this. Didn't do that. Allah knows best. He or she, they are under the mashia of Allah. And before I move on, I want you guys to mention this with me. We have a packed house here today. There's one of the ibarat, one of the phrases that we have to hear resonating with us. Under the Mashia, Mashia, under the Mashia of Allah. So I'm going to say it, Mashia, and I want you guys to say it after me. And it's not no Sufi dhikr. I just want this to be in your heads. Mashia. Good job. Good job, Ikhwani. I want to add on a word. Mashia. Mashia of Allah. What does that mean? Insha'Allah, adhabahu. Wa insha'Allah, ghafara lahu. If Allah chooses, he'll punish him. If Allah chooses, he'll forgive him. That's everybody here. Everybody here. Saddam Hussein. Saddam Hussein was on an aqidah that was whacked out, bugged out, rejected. Arab nationalism. The Arab is better. The Arab Christian, the Arab Yahudi, the Arab atheist, the Arab. As long as he's Arab, he's better than the non-Arab, even if he's a Muslim. That's kufrun in the deen of Allah. Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. The best of the people sitting here, the one who has the most taqwa. no Arab can stand up in the middle of the floor and say, I'm better than everybody else. If he did it, we're all going to jump on him. No Arab is better than us because of his nationalism. No one. And yes, it is true. I make it a point to let people know I'm proud of my African heritage. But my patriotism is to Allah, to his prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to the sunnah of the Nabi, and to the ummah of al-Islam, even the innovators who are in al-Islam. But my patriotism to them, my wala to them is based upon how and where they are. The more they're on the sunnah, the more patriotism I have towards them. The less they're on the sunnah, the less. But even the one who was way on the fringes, still my brother. Browi is still my brother. But the Browi is not like that brother, that sister who's trying to be on the sunnah. It's not the same. Not the same. But anyway, the point here is, Ikhwani, the point here is, when that man Saddam Hussein was about to get that noose and he was about to be dropped and his neck snapped from being hung, to his credit, and we don't see leaders like this anymore, and I don't support what his aqidah was, I don't support what he did before he was killed, that man was strong before he was killed. And not everybody can be like that. And they don't make leaders like that anymore. And that man made the shahada. He was tough. He was strong with those people. He wasn't scared of them. And right before they dropped him through that floor, he took the shahada. Allah knows best where his final resting place is going to be. It's not for anybody to say and put their foot in that. Especially when Jibril said, Ya Muhammad, lo ra'aytani, lamma arad Allah ta'ala yuhlika Fir'aun. Hey Muhammad, if you would have just saw me, when Allah was about to drown Fir'aun, I went very quick to the bottom of the ocean. I picked up the dirt, I put it in his mouth, so that Fir'aun wouldn't say, La ilaha illallah. Because I know the ayat. Jibril knows the ayat. Wasiyat kullu shay rahmatuhu. Wasiyat rahmatuhu kullu shay'in. Allah's rahmah extended and goes beyond everything. And here I come out with Usama. I don't like this person. He did A, B, C, D. And I'm going to say, no, he's going to be punished. Sometimes you can say that. Sometimes you can't. So as it relates to Ikhwani concerning the good signs of a good Khatima, there are quite a few issues that the Prophet told us about, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I don't say that I'm going to deal with all of them today because they are a lot. But many of them don't really relate to us because we have to be careful about what we're saying today when we find normative Islam is under attack. So when I tell you some of these things, it's not acceptable by these people for me to say some of this. So we'll mention some things that are right in front of us. We have an opportunity to deal with it. We have been dealing with it with some of our relatives. At the top of the list, any Muslim who, while he's on his deathbed, his last words are, La ilaha illallah, and then he checks out, that is a sign that that individual is going to Jannah and he had a good ending. You heard it, you saw it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa ala alihi wasallam, he said in an authentic hadith, Man kana akhir kalamihi la ilaha illallah dakhala al-jannata. Anyone who the last thing that he said before he died was no God worthy of worship except Allah, he's going to Jannah. So if we see that, then we say, this is what that man said. And based upon what is apparent, that's what we're going to go upon. And Allah knows best. And the scholars who wrote about this issue, which shows this issue was important. It's important because kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. Everybody's going to die. So everybody should be trying to get a good ending. It's important what your ending is going to be. We're not talking about the next guy. We're talking about ourselves right here. I want a last ending. A good last ending. Then let the last thing that you say be la ilaha illallah. So if you get sick and they say this disease of yours it's terminal. You're going to check out. And as time goes on, you feel like you're really going to check out. Then you write in your wasiya and you tell the people around you, when I'm about to die, if I'm about to die, maybe I won't be in my right senses like that brother's father. He has some stuff, some apparatuses down his throat. Whenever he saw his children around him, he was struggling to get up. He even pulled it out. He was struggling. He never regained enough strength to say to them what he wanted to say. It was just a struggle. So maybe you're going to be in that situation. So before you get to that thing, you make sure you tell your family, listen, Abu Bakr, listen, listen. If and when I'm about to die, I don't want any knuckleheads around me. Who's the knucklehead? The knucklehead is the guy who comes to visit the one who's sick and he starts saying, hey, 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 David Beckham, did you see what he was doing? You want people around you who are going to be saying to you, say la ilaha illallah. You want people around who are going to be reminding you of that. You don't want people around you who for 1 second, they're going to make you get distracted in that situation. You want the religious people around you. Because the person who that is his last statement, then it's a sign he went to Jannah. And it's not that easy, akhwani. If a person is not used to making the dhikr of Allah after salat, the dhikr of Allah, he doesn't know the du'as after salat, for an example. He doesn't know it. If he knew it and he did it all the time, it becomes part and parcel who he is. So even if he lost consciousness, he may say it. He may say it because it's a part of who he is. But if he's one of those people who don't know dhikr and dhikr doesn't know him, then the risk of him not saying it may be greater. But that's one of the main examples. That's one of the main characteristics. The one who the last thing he said, la ilaha illallah, again, this is the proof of why I said, because I do know some people, their mothers and fathers were not Muslims. They've been working on their mother and father for a long time, and their mother and their fathers, they knew la ilaha illallah. They knew that pinnacle principle in al-Islam. Muhammad Rasulullah, he said to his mother, hey ma, say la ilaha illallah. Say, Isa is not the son of Allah. She said it. He said it. He didn't get to the other part. The Prophet said, من كان لا إله إلا الله آخر كلامه دخل الجنة. He didn't say, whoever said لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. The Shahada, Allah created him. And he acknowledged that. And Allah's rahmah is wide. Wide. Prostitute, أكرمكم الله. باغية, it's her job. She used to do that. Her profession, she used to do that. Someone comes to his mother and says, what do you want to do when you grow up? I want to be a baghia. We throw him out of the house. What do you do? What's wrong with you? You're crazy? The lady was a baghia, prostitute. Her job. Gave the dog, the nasty kalb, water to drink. Allah Ta'ala shakara lahu, shakara laha, wa ghafara laha, wa adkhalaha al-jannah. Allah was thankful for what she did for that nasty dog. Forgave her for that nasty thing she was doing and put her in the Jannah. La ilaha illallah is no joke. Now, of course, now, if you never taught your parents about the other aspect of the Shahadatain, they don't know anything about Muhammad and so forth, so on, then, we can't play with the religion, but he or she did everything that they could to let the mother, the father, the relatives know there's Muhammad and so forth, so on. But for whatever reason, they didn't get to that. Allah's rahmah is massive, expansive. Second issue, ikhwani, is for a person who died on Jum'ah night, like after Maghrib, Thursday night, or died on Jum'ah day. Anyone, let me tell this community again. Those people who die from our community, if they die on Thursday night, which is the night of Al-Jum'ah, they die Thursday night after Maghrib, and they die the next day on Friday before Maghrib, That's a sign of a good khatima, which goes to show the seriousness and the importance of the Friday day. Friday. خَيْرُ يَوْمٍ تَلَعَتْ فِيهِ الشَّمْسُ يَوْمُ الْجُمْعَةِ. The best day that the sun came up is on the Friday. On that day, Allah created Adam. On that day, Allah put him in Jannah. On that day, Adam was expelled from Jannah. On that day, Yawm al-Qiyamah is going to happen. It's a serious day that we have a responsibility, again, of making it something that our children appreciate. We have to do those things to make this Jummah part of our lives as Al-Islam is being chiseled away and we're losing it. This is the day where I'm going to come home before the Maghrib on Friday, and I'm going to do something about this day. Take my kids out, give them some sundaes, some ice cream, going to do something, and keep telling them, I'm doing it because it's Friday. I'm doing it because it's Friday. I'm doing it because it's Friday. It's because it's Friday. It's because it's Friday. As for Sunday, the day of the Christians, Saturday, the day of the Yahud, the 2 days when it's the Ijazahs, you know, cool out day, we're off of work. Naturally, they're going to like those days, naturally. Nope, I'm doing this because it's Friday. It's Friday, it's Friday. And we plant that seed in their hearts, in their souls, in their minds, until it becomes something that at least I can say, me and my wife, you and your wife can say, I did something about maintaining their Islamic identity. I did something about making jihad, fi sabilillah. And we're going to come to that. Inshallah. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, man sama yawman ibtigha'a wajhillahi ta'ala khutima lahu biha dakhala al-jannata wa man tasaddaqa بصدقة ابتغاء وجه الله ختم له بها دخل الجنة. He said anyone or even before that, ما من مسلم يموت يوم الجمعة أو ليلة الجمعة إلا وقاه الله فتنة القبر. There is no Muslim who dies on the Jum'ah night or on the Jum'ah day except that Allah would protect him from the fitna of the qabr. So anyone who died on those 2 days is from the fadl of Allah, that Allah chose him. He didn't have anything to do with it, but he happened to die on that day. She happened to die on that day. The eyes shed tears and the heart, it weeps and it's overwhelmed with sorrow. But your loved one died on Thursday night, Jummah night, Jummah after Thursday, Maghrib. They died on Friday. Upshir, it's a good tidin. Relax. That should take away some of the sorrow. And that's from the rahmah of Allah Azza wa Jalla on his servants. It's tough. You lost your loved one, but that's a good sign. Number 3. Anyone who does any good deed in general, and he dies after doing that good deed, going to the masjid, he died. Coming from the masjid, he died. Making umrah, making hajj, he died. Any good deed, he got married. Man tazawwaja faqad istakmala nisfa dinahu falyattaqillaha fi shatr al-akhir. Anyone who got married, he completed half of his deen. It's a religion. So let him fear Allah on the other half. He said that if a person, a man, if he puts his private part in the place that is halal for him, marriage, he'll get a sadaqah. It's the deen, put in the right place. So if a person, when he got married and then he died, it's a good example. It's a good sign. Anything in the deen, anything. And I want to take this opportunity right now because part of the legacy of part of the history and legacy of being here in Green Lane is that I don't want to let the memory of our uncle, Sheikh Salim. We don't want to let you guys forget that guy. Used to pray in the first row. Pray Salatul Isha, He went home, and the racist bigot that they need to be put in, they need to be put in that prevent on those skinheads. He stabbed the sheikh like a coward. Man is over 70 years old, and you come from behind his back and stick the knife in him and you kill him. Those are from the signs that our tears shed, and we are sad at the demise of Sheikh Salim. And we wish we had the chance to deal with that guy who did that to him. But it's a sign. He died after doing a good deed. Old man walking to the masjid, walking home, and he got killed before he got home. Can I say a Sheikh Salim had a husnul khatima? I can't say wallahi. I say, but it appears that way. Allah knows best. We're not going to go overboard. We'll only say what pleases Allah. We don't know. But this darus, ikhwani, it's not some darus that's abstract. This is our real lives. Those of you who lost people, you know that you love them. You have to look for these issues to get strength to keep moving on. Don't be like those ignorant people who have no deen. When someone dies amongst their relatives and those who are close with them, they say everything that displeases Allah. Allah gives life and he takes life away. You have nothing to do with the choice. You have nothing to do with it. That's why from the dua, when someone dies, we say when we hear about it, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَا أَعْطَى وَلِلَّهِ مَا أَخَذَى وَكُلُّ شَيْءٍ عِنْدَهُ لِأَجْلٍ مُسَمَّى. To Allah belongs what he gave you in the first place. And he took it from you. And everything is here for a particular amount of time. That's what we say to our Muslim brothers. So if I'm one of those people who suffered from that, I lost a baby, my wife died, man's wife died, giving birth. He has to look for these ahadith and these ayat. She has to get strength from this stuff. It's not some abstract thing, some theory. Our religion is not theory. Salafi is not theory. It's our real lives. So, as it relates to this issue, second of all, La ilaha illallah is his last kalam, goes to Jannah, inshallah. Second kalam, anyone who dies on Friday, they go to Jannah. Third issue, anyone who does any good deed and it's the last thing he did, go to Jannah. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, innam al-a'mal bil-khawateem. Your actions and your deeds will be determined by the last things that you do. The very last thing that you do will determine you're going to Jannah, you're going to the hellfire. He said that a man would do the deeds of the people of the hellfire. He used to gamble, he used to drink, he used to smoke, he didn't pray, didn't wear hijab, blah, 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 did all of that stuff. He does the deeds of the people of the hellfire, but the qadr, what was written for him, overtakes him. Right before death, what was written for him overtakes him, he starts doing the deeds of the people of Jannah, and he goes to Jannah. And that's the tafa'ul of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's his being positive. And I got to mention this. It's kind of like an off-the-topic subject, but it's still real. Some of us, ikhwani, are extremely critical and dark parents. You kill and you suffocate your children by telling them they're no good. All you have is criticism and animosity that comes out of your mouth. So the child grows up, and after getting independence and freedom from you, they never gain independence from that death that you planted in their minds and their hearts. And some communities here in the UK, they have it more than others. I'm here to put my hand up. African Americans, we have our own issues. Someone tells me about our issues, I'm going to say, yes, that's one of our issues. You're right about that. But some of the ethnic groups from the Muslims in this country, it seems to be a consistent pattern with some of us that we kill the spirit of our children with that negativity. The Nabi told the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a person may do the deeds of a person who's from the people of the hellfire, doing all kind of craziness. But right before he dies, hand span before he dies, what was written for him overtakes him. He starts doing the deeds of the people of Jannah. And then he goes to Jannah. He dies on that thing, on the last thing that he did. So as long as the person is living, he has life in his breath, be positive. Be optimistic. Don't kill the spirit of people who are around you. Our voices and our children, our voices and our children, it's the future of those kids, inshallah. You tell your kid, you can do it. You're loved. I appreciate you. Yeah, you can do it. And you're giving them positive messages. That is the future voice that your child will always listen to, inshallah. Don't kill them. So in the hadith, in addition to what we just mentioned, that solidifies that and supports that, is the hadith I mentioned a few minutes ago. The Prophet says, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, anyone who fasts, seeking Allah's face, and then he dies after fasting, he will go to the Jannah because of that fast. Anyone who gives sadaqah, seeking Allah's face, and he dies after that sadaqah, he will go to the Jannah. And all of the deeds are like that. He prays, he comes to a darus, he gives a darus, whatever he does, whatever she does, they'll get that reward. So any good deed that a person dies on, so you know someone from your relatives who died, and they did something as small as they spoke to their parents with loving words right before they died. And you know this thing about death is crazy. This social media, it's amazing what social media exposes us to. I saw some footage in the East Coast of America. There was a snowstorm recently. It was talking about texting while you're driving. Allah knows best if they were texting. Allah knows best. But it was a two-way highway. And out of nowhere, the car is swerved just a little bit. And when it swerved a little bit, it hit a truck. And then it went to the other side of the road. And the qadr just happened. That coming the other way was a big lorry. Head on. Bam. The way the accident was, that person was done. And they never thought prior to that accident, I'm just driving. It's no problem. But that's how death is. You never know. So doing the small, kind things doesn't have to be some big thing. You bring half of your wealth to the masjid. Give the masjid your wealth. Fisabilillah, half of it. Nobody said you have to do that. Do the small things and kill the people with kindness, like calling people up and saying, hey, mom, sorry. Hey, dad, I'm sorry. It's apologizing to people. Just being consistent in trying to do the right thing. If you check out after that, it's a sign of a good death. And if we are aware of that, we hold on to that, no matter how insignificant or how significant it happens to be. From the issues, ikhwani, we're going to speed this up, is al-istishhad, a person who gets shahada fi sabilillah. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, there are over 20 people who can fit in this particular bab. They come under the umbrella of a shahada, the real shahada, the real shahada, that we will not apologize to the non-Muslims about normative Islam and normal Islam, al-jihad and shahadas from our religion. And you can't come and make us say it's not from our religion. But we will say there is a correct understanding of jihad and there's an incorrect one. And there is a correct understanding of al-istishhad and an incorrect one. Some of our brothers who are leaning towards, and they have an intimat. They are people who are connecting themselves to the Ikhwan al-Muslimin. They connect themselves to al-Jamaat al-Islamiyah. People from Pakistan, people from Afghanistan, people from Bangladesh. Whenever they say Sayyid Qutb, they say al-Shaheed Sayyid Qutb, al-Shaheed Abu A'la al-Mawdudi. We say, don't say that. Don't say that. Because if a person is a shaheed, he's going to Jannah. And if a person is a shaheed, he's going to get a lot of rewards. He won't get any adab if he's really a shaheed. How can you establish that for Sayyid Qutb? How? How can you establish that for Abu A'la al-Mawdudi? And unfortunately, because of ignorance and asabiyah, asabiya, fanaticism. If a person hears me saying this, I'm his enemy because I'm telling them this. I'm saying to you, pump your brakes and slow down. Shahada is with Allah. Just because a person is killed just like that doesn't mean he got shahada. Doesn't mean that. Especially if it's people who we know are saying things and doing things that are not in harmony with what the religion is saying. So concerning al-istishhad, getting the shahada, there are many. At the top of the list is the person who really goes out fi sabilillah and he loses his life defending Islam. He loses his life defending Islam. Or if you can imagine, this is the property and the territory of al-Islam. This masjid and the walls of the masjid. This is the property and the territory. Our homes are here and the masjid, this whole place, if you can imagine it, being bigger. There are some people from our Shabab, they go out to the frontiers. They go out to the borders, of the Islamic State. They're not fighting. They're just out on the borders protecting the Muslims from danger. That's one of the people, if he gets killed in that state, the Prophet ﷺ said, he's a shaheed. He gets killed out there. He's a shaheed. How did he get killed? The enemy shot him. A drone missile blew him up. Yeah. A scorpion stung him. A snake stung him. Yeah. All of that. Because he's making a big sacrifice. He's out there helping the community. Protecting Islam. In Islam is the young brother. He's going to memorize the Quran. In Islam is another brother. His daughter's going to marry the Mahdi. In Islam, in the community, is another individual, and on and on and on. He's out there and he's protecting. He's one of those people. Now, obviously, during this time, this is not what we are going after because we're not even living in the Muslim lands, but this is one of the people. Under this umbrella are many. From them is what the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said to his companions, who do you people consider to be the shaheed fi sabilillah? Who do you think is the shaheed? The people say, Ya Rasulullah, the shaheed is the one who takes his sword, gets on his horse, he goes out and he fights fi sabilillah. He said, okay, if that's true, then the martyrs, the shuhada of my ummah are only a few. They're only a few. And then he went on to tell them, the shaheed of my ummah is the one who died from drowning. And I want to take this opportunity out again. And our history here in Birmingham and Green Lane, and our legacy here in Birmingham and Green Lane, that brother who died last Ramadan when he went to one of these cities, I think he was in Switzerland. What's that brother's name? Brother Bashir, who died drowned. He drowned to death. He drowned. And after I heard the news of that, I didn't know who's this Bashir. Then I saw his picture. I said, wow, I knew that guy. So I went with a brother who prays with us in Hardtop Road. And I went to his house and I met his mother and his father. And subhanAllah, his mother was saying, inshallah, he's a shaheed. Somali lady. She was saying, inshallah, that's her son. She can remember all of the years of that boy. When he was born until when she heard the news, he died. But what helped to strengthen her is the kalam of the Nabi, that these people want to come and wipe it out of the minds of our children and ourselves. We're going to say, kalla wallahi. Not if we can do something about it. Not if we can do something about it. We're going to hang on to our religion. And we're going to do our best, inshallah, to hang on to the religion of our children as well. He said, if the shaheed is only the individual who dies getting killed, fi sabilillah, then the shuhada of this religion are a few. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the shaheed is the individual who drowned and the individual who a wall fell on him. A wall fell on him. I can't speak for you guys, you women, I don't know. But I've seen the air footage of what has happened to Syria and how it has been decimated. I don't know. I guess they were in a helicopter. Maybe it was a drone, you know, a drone taking a picture. I think it was probably a drone flying over the cities of Syria. All of the buildings are messed up. All of them. The land of Al-Imam Al-Oza'i. Just look, it's unbelievable. It's surreal. Syria. 10 years ago, Syria was one of the metropolitan cities of the Muslims. And you look at it now, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Okay, when we see that footage of those bombs and we become upset, like many of our youngsters get upset and they want to become extreme, we say, hey, we understand where they're coming from, but it's not okay. What we have to say is, people who died when those buildings fell on them and collapsed on them, those children who were buried alive, all of those poor men and women who were buried alive, we say, inshallah, let that come off our tongues. They died with shahada. Asa an takrahu shay'an wa huwa khayrun lakum. It may be that you hate something and it's better for you. Allahu a'lam. Don't be one of those people who sit back and say, why? How did this happen? Why would Allah? Don't be like that. Say, hey, inshallah, they got the shahada. So anyone who a building fell on him, then that individual, inshallah, also died as a shaheed. From this issue are many people. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من قتل دون ماله فهو شهيد ومن قتل دون دينه فهو شهيد ومن قتل دون عرضه فهو شهيد. Anyone who dies protecting his money, and he got killed protecting his money, he's a shaheed. Good sign. If he died protecting his money, protecting his religion, protecting his honor, he gets killed as a result of defending his wife, defending his daughters, defending his family from people who are trying to harm him, intruders, and so forth, so on. Just to speed this up, because we have to get finished, inshallah, as we said before, 9:30 or at 9:30, inshallah. Our women, who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to tell the community that I am agitated because of the two weak people from the community, and one of them is the orphan and the other one is the woman. He said that any woman who is killed, her baby kills her. That's how he said it. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Al-mar'atu yaqtuluha waladuha. The woman who her child killed her. That's how he put it. Her child killed her. She's a shaheed. In another narration, he said that the baby will come yawm al-qiyamah with the umbilical cord connected to his mother, pulling his mother into the Jannah. So I think we all know some people who, the lady, she died as a result of childbirth. And the Prophet ﷺ didn't say childbirth killed her, he said her child killed her. Maybe the child lived, or maybe the child died. She goes to Jannah. Because it's big jihad, big jihad. Any lady who lost one child, two child, three children, and she lived and they died, she's going to go to Jannah. That's a big musibah. Girl lost a baby, two babies, three babies. How does she deal with that? She puts it in perspective. That baby will be waiting for her, yawm al-qiyamah, making noise with other babies, trying to get the mother into Jannah. So the Muslim has to put these issues into perspective, and he has to put them in a way that will give him strength. I just want to go very quickly and just mention very quickly from the people who will go into Jannah, and it's a good khatima, is the one who died as a result of a plague. Like here in the UK, they had the bubonic plague. They had that plague, and people were dying left, right, and center. At that time, they weren't too keen on hygiene, and it killed a lot of people. The rats of Birmingham was killing a lot of people. So as a result of that, if a Muslim finds himself in that situation, it's a sign of a good khatima. Take it easy. Be patient. He also mentioned anyone who has a stomach disease. Anyone had cancer of the stomach, his intestines burst, he had a hernia, couldn't get medical treatment, and he died. anything connected with the stomach. Rahmah of Allah. I think many of us have experienced how you can get a very severe stomach ache as a result of the way the food is moving in your stomach. You just get that sharp pain and it only lasts for a few seconds. There are people who live like that, day in and day out. They need morphine. They need morphine just to exist. So anyone who dies as a result of a stomach ailment, it's a sign of a good khatima. The person who dies from TB, you guys know what TB is? What's that? Tuberculosis. When I was in El Medina, they took us all in my class, 35 people, and we had to get a TB test. I don't remember exactly what they did, but I know I had a circle on my arm, and it came from a brother who was from, not Somalia, the other place, Djibouti. He was the one who had TB, and he's in the class with us. And then another brother was saying, yeah, but if we all get tuberculosis, we're going to, I said, man, don't give me that stuff. I'm not trying to die from no tuberculosis. I want to go to Mecca. I want to go to Hajj and go to Mecca. What are you talking about? Tuberculosis. I want to live. But anyone who gets that TB, and he dies from that, then that individual, inshallah, is a good sign. Lastly, pleurisy. Pleurisy. Dr. Abu Hanifa. What is pleurisy? What is that, pleurisy? He has chest issues, huh? So he goes, he gets the x-rays. They can look at the x-rays and they can say, Your lungs are cloudy and stuff like that. And then you get that pleurisy. Anyone who dies from that as well. If your relative dies as a result of having, maybe it's pneumonia. It's like pneumonia. Pleurisy. So may Allah save us from all of these diseases. We're going to stop right here, inshallah ta'ala. And we ask Allah ta'ala to give everybody here longevity and prosperity. And when we do check out, we check out upon the Kitab and the Sunnah. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
JazakAllah, brothers and sisters, for attending. JazakAllah khair. Next week's lecture will be titled Life in the Grave, and it will be delivered by our brother Suhaib Hussein. BarakAllah fiq for attending, and see you next week, inshallah. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.